In this part of Shop Talk, I'll be specifically addressing some measuring instruments that I would suggest that you consider when you're starting out in your home shop to build these little small engines. Also, take a look at some tooling that you're going to need with the lathe. I know I talked about some of it, but I think those were the more of the essential ones. I'm going to show you three or four things that I think you should probably be getting as soon as you get a lathe. And again, I'll just take you through the toolbox over here. This is not considered a toolbox tour by any means. I don't have too much to tour with, really. But over the years, I've accumulated some things. I've made some mistakes along the way. I've spent some money on things that I don't use. But yet, there's a handful of things, instruments to measure with, that are pretty essential that you're going to build if you're going to build engines. Now, the good thing is you can get a lot of these that are offshore. eBay is a good source. I'll talk about a couple of ways that you might can get some good deals off eBay just by the way you search and so forth. And again, I will end up with some tooling that I think is going to be useful for your lathe, and it'll just be three or four things that I'll talk through about it. So let's go on over and take a look at the toolbox. Okay, the toolbox that you're looking at, as you can see, is a pretty old toolbox. It's an old Craftsman. I got this at a yard sale or a flea market or somewhere. I did not give much for it. I think I gave probably less than $30 for it. But this is this pretty much holds all my measuring instruments. And I'll just go through drawer by drawer and talk about some things that I think you're probably going to need again sooner than later. And again, not all inclusive, and I'm sure your list is going to be slightly different, but most of these are going to be required for someone starting out. You're going to need, when you do your precision work, you're going to need a micrometer. Now, this is a Stuart micrometer. My dad bought it. I did not buy that, but he did. This Chinese version of a 0 to 1 inch is, you're going to use that when you're building small engines almost 100% of the time. But if you need to do something else, by all means, you can get some bigger mics. This is a measuring gauge here that goes inside and also can be adjusted to measure some angles along the way. And this right here was just an eBay find. Also, I'm not rolling my own here, but cigarette papers are going to be real important. And I use this when I'm setting up my milling machine. And what you do, you just pull off a cigarette paper, put it up to what you're working in, and when your mill touches that, or when your cutting mill touches that, that means you're 1/1000th away, or whatever your cigarette paper is. Always keep a few band-aids around too. But the essential ones in this drawer right here are going to be a micrometer, and I would highly recommend that you get some kind of a depth gauge like that. I went over to the next drawer. You're going to need some dividers. The most common divider that you're going to use is this divider right here, and I prefer the smaller ones. This is a 4-inch, I believe, and when I'm working on small stuff, I prefer the 4-inch. And you can get the set with 6-inch dividers. They're very popular. You can get those from Harbor Freight. You can get them from a lot of different places. And the 6-inch is fine, but I find those to be just a little bit on the large size. I prefer the smaller ones. This is a set of inside calipers, and this is just another set of inside calipers. A lot of times you find stuff and it's more than one in it. You're also going to need several. These are little rulers. They're called scales. That's the official name, and they're going to be everywhere. You'll be surprised at things that you find that you're going to need to keep in your toolbox. For example, that's an emery board. That's what that is. Just one of those little free things that you pick up somewhere. I also recommend that you get a square. This is for setups and for layout works. If you notice, it's got the big thick edge on it so that you can get your layout done when you're marking on your metal. This is a drawer that eventually you're going to need. I'll try to get these in order of what you'll need. You'll need something like this to start with to measure inside bores. And if you can see, the ends there are just hooked out a little bit. And you can measure an inside bore pretty accurate with that. However, to get it really close up is these little inside bore gauges. And there's lots of videos on YouTube on how to use those things. Keith Finner has an excellent set, Mr. Pete 222. Has got some excellent videos on how to use these things here. They're very easy to use. I do recommend that you get that set. And these can be found off Harbor Freight and eBay pretty inexpensively. For little bitty bores and You're not going to really use this too much because almost all the steam engines that you're probably going to be building or internal combustion engines that you're building starting out are going to be at least with a 3/4 inch bore. If you're using at least a 3/4 inch or 1/2 inch bore, you can use these. But if you're on really tiny bores or you're working in your machine shop with screw holes and so forth, you'll need these and they're small bore gauges. I don't use outside the calipers a great deal. I use a dial caliper and a digital caliper. But that's the way they did it for years and years. I seldom bring those out. Now, if I'm working in the wood shop, I use them quite a bit more. This is called a Murphy-Dyked caliper. Bought that. That's one of the things that you can save your money on. Hardly ever use that because there's so many ways that you can do what this does and several other ways. Again, scale in that drawer. This one is, you can pick this up at Lowe's, or you can pick it up off eBay. This is a General tool, is who makes this. This is a protractor, and I actually have a real serious digital protractor that goes down in minutes and seconds, but almost everything that I do, I can be done with this small protractor right here. These two things right here, I keep getting asked about them. Here's the other one. And, you know, I get sometimes asked how I make those and everything. Maybe I'll do a very quick video, but these, they're seldom anytime I don't work in the shop that I'm not using this little thing right here. And that's nothing but a 16th inch piece of music wire with a 16th hole drilled through a piece of keystock and an Allen screw or a hex screw. And then I just got a little piece of hex brass and pressed it on there. And this is a combination depth gauge. When I'm cutting something off the lathe, I can stick that wire up in it to keep it from falling. Again, that's the first tool I made. It's 20 years ago or so when I first started in the home shop, and still use it almost every time I turn the lathe on or working around the shop. If you get a chance, this is on your secondary list, but I would recommend that you get what's called a die maker square, especially if you're working on small engines, because you can slide this piece here up in the middle, and there's just several measurements that you'll need to make. It also comes with an extra blade on it for getting the angles and so forth. Some things you buy, or I bought thinking, I might need that someday, and I don't. These are actually made by Stuart. They're called tool buttons, and if you want to drill a hole precisely, and I mean down to the half thousandths, this is how you do that. You can see video tubes out of YouTube's video on YouTube's on how to use these little buttons right here. But they are phenomenally accurate when they're set up right. I never use them, but I got them at a good deal. You'll find yourself doing that. This drawer over here is a go-to drawer. This one here has things that are used almost every time. One of the instruments that you're going to need, and I rank this right up there with your micrometer and your dial caliper, is going to be a little 6-inch square. Again, you can get the 12-inch square just like you can get the 6-inch dividers a while ago, but I prefer the 6-inch size. And, I mean, if you can find one that's got everything on it, including your center finder, and you've got your protractor and your square, it's just unbelievable how many times that you're going to use this. And this brings me to a tip when you're buying tools off of eBay. There's people out through there that have no interest at all, I suppose, in machining, but they just collect Stuart instruments, measuring instruments. And they collect these Stuart instruments, and they have just driven the price up to where it's almost unbelievably expensive. A tip that I would offer when you're buying stuff off eBay and your instruments that you're looking for, search under Lufkin or Brown and Sharp, and you'll find pretty much the same thing at least 25 to 30% less expensive. And I bought this several years ago, but I don't think I gave probably $20 for this thing right here, where if that had been Stuart, that could have easily been $100. Also, don't forget to search under Craftsman. This is back when Craftsman made really good and supplied excellent stuff when they did that. And this is a 6-inch square, and it's made by Craftsman, or Craftsman had it made for someone. It's not made in China. It's made in America, and it really is of excellent quality. But you're going to need that. That's just unbelievable when on layout work how often that you're going to need this 6-inch protractor. Other things that you're going to need, I do recommend, are some kind of a chamfer tool, and this is a deburring tool. So none of those are very expensive, but I recommend that you think about getting those. See, we looked in that one. This one right here is a drawer. Now, there's very few things in here that you're actually going to need to start with, but you're going to need some of this to start with. Over here, I've got my carbide inserts. Now, if you use carbide tooling, you're going to have to buy the insert. That doesn't come with it, usually, and if it does, you only get one. But that's carbide inserts. What I recommend that you do, especially if you're starting out, is to look on eBay or look at auction sales and so forth, and see if you can buy a box or a lot, a seller's lot, not necessarily a whole bunch, but just a lot, a seller's lot of ground tooling. And that's what I buy a lot of times, and it's just what people have already preformed and thrown away and don't need anymore, and you can pick that up pretty inexpensively compared to new stock. For example, here's one right here that came out of a seller's lot, and it's has a 60-degree cutting thread already ground in it. So very, very useful, but you're going to need some type of cutting tool. You're also going to need to think about some boring tools. And, you know, this is a homemade tool here. I think I showed this one is for finding the center. But that's a homemade tool I made. I don't want to talk about it right now. I might make a video on that someday. But these are all the boring tools. And you're going to need to look at boring tools if you're going to be building engines, because you've got to make your cylinder. You don't need a whole bunch of them. I would recommend somewhere along the line of 3/8 of an inch, and a 3/8 of an inch will get you up to a 1/2 inch to 3/4 inch bore without doing a lot of flex. If you're doing small work, you might have to look at a 1/4 inch boring bar, and they go down extremely small when you're doing that. And down at the bottom are things that I don't really use a whole lot, and just to show you what you can make and get by for years, I seldom ever use a sine bar, a S-I-N-E, sine as in sine and cosine. I seldom ever use it, but for years and years, I use this homemade sine bar that's nothing but a piece of cold rolled 1/4 inch steel, and I turned two buttons that are exactly 5 inches apart on the center. And if it's 5 inches apart, then I can use my sine table. And then I got fancy and found one of these on eBay, and I bought it, looked pretty, hadn't used it since. Probably in 20 or 25 years, I haven't used a sine bar but once or twice. And then I could have done it another way easily. So I recommend that you don't spend a lot of money on your sine bar. Same thing with this level. Nice, pretty, easy to look at. It's made by Stuart, didn't pay much for it, never use it. Slitting saws, wouldn't waste my money on it starting out. These are dial indicators. This is the one that comes in from the back, and this is the one that's got the little thing sticking out the front of it for measuring it very small. This is the number one tool in the shop. I recommend that you stick with a dial caliper. These are made in China. They're pretty inexpensive. They're very accurate for home shop work. I recommend this so many times over a digital caliper. I just don't like the digital caliper at all. Every time I pick one up, it looks like the battery's dead in it. That's why I keep batteries in the toolbox. Down the line, eventually, for setups for the home shop, you might want to consider what they call a planer gauge. There's lots of videos on YouTube on how to use a planer gauge, but you're probably going to need eventually to look at that. If you've got a milling machine, which I do recommend that you get, you're going to need some type of wiggler to find the center. This is the one I use all the time. I didn't pay a whole lot for it. It's inexpensive, does a great job, and gets the job done. Again, don't ever think about, or don't ever forget about making homemade tools. And when I first started, I was needing some kind of way to measure the vertical height. Well, what I did, I just got a 1-inch square block of aluminum. I cut this part off right here. That little edge of it is cut off. And then I put two hex bolts in it, set it at a 90-degree angle, and now I can set that down just like that, and then I can measure off the side of it. And, you know, I use that thing pretty often. Another thing I wouldn't waste a whole lot of money on are radius gauges. For years, I used a flat washer for my radius. and worked perfect. I just happened to find those inexpensive, and I don't think I've used them in 4 or 5 years since I bought them. But if you're a tool and die maker, you got to have that. But home shop, you don't necessarily need to have that. Coming on down to this next little old cheapo box, that's just junk. Again, sometimes you buy stuff, it's cheap, but you know, cheap is not cheap when you buy it and you'll never use it. So I probably didn't pay a whole lot for that, but I'd rather have my dollar or $2 back making me money in the bank. Well, not the bank anymore, but somewhere or another making me money than sitting in a toolbox. But sometimes you just fall because it's a good deal. Don't do that. Only buy what you need. And when you do buy stuff, or when you make stuff, jigs and fixtures and so forth, never throw them away. Everything in this drawer that you see here at one time was used to hold something, make something, bend something. There, everything in here, and most of it is a one-purpose deal. Like, I don't even remember what I made that for. But at the time, I needed that. You know, it surprises me sometimes how often that I'll come back to this drawer and I'll find something that I can modify or fits absolutely perfectly. There's a mandrel at one time that I built. Here's another mandrel. I was turning something, probably a wheel for a live steam locomotive, and I needed a mandrel that had some pretty good back on it to hold something, so I turned that. So now I try to turn them to some kind of a nominal size, quarter, 5/16, 3/16 or something, so I can have multiple uses for it. Sometimes you don't need to do any much precision work. You just need to hold something to turn in a circle. That's just a piece of hot roll, not even cleaned up. But I put it in the chuck. Once it was in the chuck and never taken out, that part right there was centered. And there's nothing in there that you'll need offhand. Then coming on down to the next one, these are my electronic dial calipers that I never use because the battery's usually dead in them every time I pick them up. Nothing in there you need. That's just storage. Adjustable parallels are something that I'd put on your list, not as essential, but pretty quickly. These are great for taking measurements and setups in a milling machine when you just need to get something at a precise height. That's really good to do that with. Again, here's one of those 12-inch protractor square gadgets, and that's where it stays. Never use it. This little case here, I think at one time may have had brake parts that came out of an automotive store that they were throwing something away. These are real good to keep end mills in, and also reamers. I keep my reamers in hot water PCV pipe and just put a couple of ends on it and then just mark on the side like this one's quarter inch reamer and so forth. So I keep that. So as you can see, most of my tools are not very elaborate. Here is one of those inexpensive surface blocks, and you know, I bought that thing. Again, it was a good deal. I think somebody had them on special and I was in town and didn't have to pay freight on it. Probably didn't. I think maybe I gave $15 or $20 for it. And even though it's not heavy, it's more than I want to deal with. It's probably 25 or 30 pounds. It's just a block of granite. For years and years and years, what I laid out on was a piece of plate glass. And I think I could also do the same thing today just by going to Lowe's and just buying a granite tile, like counter tile. And yeah, I know somebody probably put in comments that that's not as accurate as a surface plate is, and they would be absolutely right. It wouldn't be accurate, but it would be accurate enough for almost anything that you do in a home shop, and you could just slide that up somewhere instead of leaving it on the floor like that to fall on somebody's toe. Well, that showed you a little bit of the measuring instruments that I use here in my little home shop. Again, I want to iterate, it is not all-inclusive. Nor should yours necessarily be exactly like that. But that'll give you an idea of some of the things that I consider essential in setting up your shop. Now, someone's going to know how much that cost. And, you know, I really don't know because some of it I bought when I first started. Some of it I got in a box that I may have paid some money for and then through swapping, you know, recovered my cost and so forth. But I'm going to just throw a number out there that if you had to buy everything that I showed you new, and if you were going to buy the comparable item, by that I mean
If it was a Chinese item that I showed you and you went and bought another Chinese item, if it was a Sterrett item that I showed you, or a Lufkin or Brown and Sharp, and you went and bought essentially that same brand today. So we're comparing apples and apples, and I'm going to go that if you got it used and not new, that you waited a little bit and were patient. I would say that everything that I showed you today, given those two conditions, could probably be located for somewhere around $200. So again, you don't have to spend a whole lot of money to set up your shop. And as I say all the time, patience makes me more money than anything I can do. Patience makes me more money than my job does. If I just sit long enough and wait, I can save a lot of money. The idea of getting it right now, and I got to have it right now, that's pretty expensive. So I take the other route. If you need it right now, and that's perfectly fine, you may spend a little bit more than that. But I still think you might get it for around $300. Anyway, enough yakking, enough talking. I'll see you on the next video. We'll take a look at the lathe on that one.